I've put together a bunch of material. And so you're going to see some of these things the same way I look at them. I have some of the tools that I use to look at the data. And I'm going to expose it right in that same format. So I have a few pre-canned little videos, but most of them are the things that I do when I'm actually looking at what's happening myself. So that's the format. Let's just get into it. And I wanted to start off with three short little videos just to remind you what happened and give you a sense. And we're going to be talking about the North Tower, the South Tower, and Building 7. So here is, first of all, a little video about the South Tower, which is the second tower hit, but it's the first one that came down. And notice it sort of tips over as it comes down. Just the top part tips over, and yet the rest of the building came down anyway. So all these are just different views of the same incident. And this is the initiation of the collapse right here. Okay, I don't memorize little details like this. It's around an hour, I believe, 56 minutes, and the other one was about an hour and a half, more or less. I just had those round numbers in my head. Somebody have the exact numbers there? Okay, so hour and a half-ish, right? And then the third building, Building 7, came down at 5:20 in the evening, or afternoon, whatever you consider 5:20 to be. Notice the liquid metal pouring out of the walls here. All right. There's a lot of discussion. Basically, it looks like molten iron or molten steel. Some people try to claim it's molten aluminum, but molten aluminum in the air looks silvery at those temperatures. So, good question. Or maybe it's not a good question. Maybe it's a way of evading the question. And one of the things I've done some looking at is these things that go shooting out ahead of the debris. Okay, that was the South Tower. Here comes the North Tower. Well, that wasn't supposed to do that. Let's try that again. There. North Tower, you can tell because it has the antenna on top. You can also tell because it's the only tower in the scene when it comes down, because the other one's already gone. And it tended to come much more straight down. It actually tipped a little bit, but sort of away from us. But nowhere near what the South Tower did, at least initially. And I've spent a good deal of effort analyzing this particular collapse. And here is a more distant view. And I'm going to be coming back to details about these as we go through the evening here. Notice little squibs shooting out the sides. Well, little jets, look at a lot of them here. It looks like explosions coming out the sides. They're pretty obviously explosions, if you ask most observers, but pretty much everything you see, people have devised elaborate rationalizations on how it's something else. So. A lot of what we're trying to do is we're trying to absolutely nail down the true nature of what was happening.
How far away is Building 7 from the other two?
It was about 100 meters, pretty much due north of the North Tower. So in this view right here, the North Tower would have been just beyond where the building is we saw. It would have been just to the right of the building from here. Yeah. And it was not hit by an airplane.
What is their excuse?
Fire. Well, we'll come to that. But good question, isn't it? You want to see that one again?
Yeah.
How many of you, this is a good question, most audiences where this stuff is presented, there's a substantial fraction. How many of you until tonight had not seen Building 7 come down? Okay, now turn around and look at the hands, folks. And one of the questions you need to ask yourself is, How could we be this far into this whole episode and have a significant number of alert, active, knowledgeable people who read the paper and follow the news not be aware of this building coming down? I mean, that in itself says something. Okay.
Did anybody catch it, watch it that afternoon? I actually did. I'd come home from Tulare, and I was watching CBS, and I actually saw the reporting that said the building down, and I never put two and two together.
It was shown on TV the first day, and that was it. Oh, well, how many of you were not aware of it coming down? How many had ever seen it? So you had not seen it come down, right? I'm going to play it one more time. Notice that it came down in a very different way than the two towers. That's another good question. They say no. But then again, there's some evidence that yes. Okay, so... There's all kinds of things going on. There is evidence that it was, there was evidence of foreknowledge as early as like 10 in the morning. And there's a famous video that's on YouTube. I didn't take a clip tonight. Excuse me? There's a famous video on YouTube that has a group of firefighters around a payphone. And they're trying to call home and tell their families they're okay. And while they're standing there, you hear this loud explosion. And then they get together and say, the building is talking about building 7. Yeah, 7, you know, is doing that. They say, anyway, they're just talking about this. It has recently been verified by people who found the payphone that they called from, and like they verified the different things in the scene that they could nail it. This is the payphone, it's a couple blocks away. And from the direction of sunlight, that explosion that you hear happened before noon. It was sometime in the, probably after the second building had come down, but prior to noon, based on the sun. So, in other words, there's already evidence of explosions in Building 7 that early in the morning. So, these, if you get on YouTube, is a great video source. But anyway, let's, okay. I'm going to do this again.
It collapsed after a single.
All right, I'm going to start it again. This is a new system for me, so I'm gonna pause it here. The building was not hit by a plane. It came down at 5:20 on 9/11. The official explanation is it collapsed after a single column buckled, and then that supposedly started a cascading effect with columns. But now, given the idea of a column failing leading to other columns failing, try to put that in your head with what you see here. Here you go. Notice there's a little kink in the roof line. There's a little folding going on. But essentially, the roof line is horizontal, and it just comes down. And unlike the towers, where the explosions begin at the top and spray material all over the place, like 600 feet away, some of the material from the towers were ejected as far as 600 feet. And I've timed some of them. I've done some retiming. Anyway, it's safe to say that stuff was major... sections of girders and things were thrown out at least like 50 miles an hour. Okay, and so the mechanism for all this happening is definitely a question.
Building
7? Yeah. There were fires on a number of floors, but it was not exactly, it's not what you think of as a building engulfed in fire.
How did they catch fire?
Okay, well, the official story is it caught fire from material ejected when the North Tower came down, and there were scars in the building from the North Tower hitting it. However, there's also some of the guys in our organization who have traced some of this down, and there's no photographic evidence of fire in Building 7 before noon. And so how would the North Tower have started the fires and yet not have them in evidence, not have them visible, for another couple of hours? So there's also a lot of reason to believe that they were started in some other way. Okay, but the official story is they were started by the North Tower coming down. Basically, it's government security agencies, there were banks, there were...
Giuliani's emergency bunker
was there. Carolyn?
Still
Yeah, I think Laurel mentioned it, but the Enron records that, and supposedly it was the only copies, how convenient. Right. Okay. Now, the way I'm coming at this, this is sort of like a personal approach here. I'm coming at this as a physics teacher. I see things happen, and I say, how did that happen? And so this is a little, what I'm doing here is sort of illustrating a tool that I use in my teaching in a sort of a native context. Here I am at school, standing on a ladder with a soccer ball, and going, whomp, there's a physics experiment. That wasn't very smooth. Let's do it again. Boom. All right. Notice that this is a tool. What happens is you can go through it frame by frame and place little markers on something. And as you step through it frame by frame, like this, by the way, notice over here, if this jumps all over, okay. That thing right there is tracing where it is on the graph. And so by tracing, in other words, you have to manually put these, this, what I'm using as my mouse pad is causing this to jump. I don't know how I can fix that, but that's partly why this is so hard to control. Okay. So you get the general idea. This is a graph over here of position versus time, vertical position versus time. And notice that as I run it, if you watch this and watch the ball come down, it's like just watching a movie of the ball come down. But you can also do things like this. You can take, say, the vertical velocity. And notice this is a different kind of graph. And I want to explain this slightly because this is going to come into the picture in a few minutes. All right? As the velocity, if you look at the velocity as this thing comes down, it starts at rest, so it starts off at zero, like the zero there. And then as it comes down, it picks up speed. And it picks up uniform increments of speed in equal amounts of time. Okay, and that's the nature of what's called uniform acceleration. And that's characteristic of gravity. And so I wanted to let you see what that looks like. So we're graphing the velocity as a function of time. One of the things I can do is put this in an analyze mode. And it can start playing games with the graphs and the numbers. And so, for instance, I want to fit a graph to this. I'm going to select the range of data that I'm going to base it on. And I'm going to auto-fit this line. Let's make it a little bit more visible here. Hi.
Hi.
Aha. I just have a Self-Help Enterprises mouse pad. Thank you. And it's working better. Great. All right. Self-Help Enterprises, by the way. Bard McAllister, for those of you who don't know it, was the founder of that in Farm Labor Committee under his leadership, founded the Self-Help Enterprises there. Okay, a forerunner in the sense of habitat and that kind of a thing, right? Okay. Notice that if I put a straight line through the data, and then you look at this little number down here, it says 9.70. If I try it again, if I take a few data points, notice the, it's trying to fit the line to the data, and data typically has a little bit of jitter to it, and so depending on how many data points I use and how accurately they were measured and all that, you're getting slightly different versions down here. And that's characteristic of any kind of data that you take in a measurement situation, okay? So, precise science is not necessarily one exact number. It's reasonably interpreting data, taking into account the kinds of errors that show up in measurement, okay? And notice this is 9.77 at this point right here. So this is very close to what would be considered the acceleration of gravity. 9.79 in this area, 9.8, a lot of places, all right? The reason I'm giving you that is that number is going to come back into the picture every once in a while. That's called G, or the acceleration of gravity. And it's also called free fall. And notice all we're talking about here is a soccer ball dropping under the influence of gravity, and this is how fast the speed builds up. So it's not correct to say how fast do things fall. When I drop something, How fast does it fall? Well, how about in the first tenth of a second, how fast did it fall? It was hardly moving, was it? It picks up speed as it falls farther, and so what's characteristic of falling motion is not what is the speed, it's what is the acceleration. What's the rate of increase of the speed? Is that clear? You have to have a little bit of a physics lesson if you're going to listen to me talk about 9/11. Okay, there we go. Anyway, so this is the kind of a tool, and the way I use it at school. Notice you can take lots of data and play all kinds of games with it much faster than when I was in school. We plotted each individual point with a pencil on a piece of graph paper. I still have students do that somewhat. Okay. Now, let's go back to 9/11. Let's play the same game with a building. When I saw, when I knew about Building 7, I had already heard that various people had measured the rate of acceleration of the corner of the building and had by various methods determined that it had come down either at or close to free fall. Now, what are the implications of a building collapsing straight down at free fall? Free fall is like a soccer ball with nothing under it. If you have vertical columns in a building, you have a lot of material in the building, then you have a lot of work to do crushing things as this thing is coming down. How is that going to happen at free fall? If you have energy due to the fact that all this stuff is stacked up high in the air, that energy gets transferred into motion. It's called kinetic energy once you get it moving. But if you have it doing things along the way, like breaking up concrete and steel and so forth, you're using some of the energy, and therefore it can't pick up as much speed as it would otherwise. And so the energy has to go somewhere, and it can't go everywhere. So if it starts off as what's called potential energy right now, if it is doing work along the way, it'll be coming down at less than free fall. What I did was I measured it. And so here I'm just playing it straight through. And this little corner right over here, okay, I didn't turn that on. I'll turn it on next time through. But notice the building coming down. Let's turn on the little dots now. And so I start taking the data just as it's about to fall. There we go. This little red dot's the one that I originally plotted. And all I'm doing is I'm putting a little marker on each frame to get a measurement. Now, to get this would measure it in pixels on the screen, but how do I know how actual far it is? What I had to do was get some sort of a known measurement. At first, I used the width of the building, but there's a problem. Look at this left edge. It's sort of foggy because of all that smoke, right? So I had to sort of estimate it. And I got sort of a number in the ballpark of free fall. But when, in August of 2008, so just a little over a year ago, year and a half ago, NIST, which is the government agency that was put in charge of investigating these building collapses, they came out with their quote-unquote final report. It was called their final report for public comment. So it's sort of like the next to the most final report, okay? And in that report, it gave the height of the roof line and it gave the height of the 29th floor. The top of the windows of the 29th floor is what they said. They gave those two heights down to the nearest inch. And I was able to use that data, convert it to meters, and put it in here. So now I had a good calibration. And what I came up with was that this corner came down essentially at G. My actual measurements, remember I said there's a little bit of round off and that kind of thing? My actual measurements are slightly faster than G. Now, I don't really believe there's some mechanism that's, you know, rockets pushing it down faster than gravity, but let me say it is not almost at G. It's not sort of 90% of G. It's at least G, and there could be some, who knows, just because it's tilting and things like that, there could be reasons this point is coming down a little faster. When NIST came out with this report, all right, you see how fast it's coming down, and here's the actual data. Let me just go ahead and put this on analyze. I'll let you see for yourself. It's actually, if anything, it's a little bit more than G. So let's say fit align, and let's say auto fit. And look at this number here. It says 1.03. This is E1. That means move it over one place. That's 10 point something. So the slope of that line indicates the acceleration. It's at least 9.8. It's actually a little over 10 according to this measurement. Okay? Now, with that in mind, with something so straightforward for somebody. Now, this is high school physics, guys. It's maybe not all of you had high school physics, but it's not like graduate level. It's not rocket science. It's something that a typical 11th or 12th grade student would be expected to be able to do on their own. Okay? Now, NIST's value for the fall of the building, the way they phrased it is, it came down 40% slower than free fall. Now, in the first place, they didn't talk about acceleration. They talked about time. And they said the time it took to come down was 40% longer than free fall would have been. And so they're using sort of, in a sense, deceptive constructs to even talk about this. But what they're getting at is, hey, this is nowhere near free fall. And that's a problem. Okay?
So you're saying you're lying.
Oh, yeah, let's start with that. Okay, let's see what I'm saying. This part's going to be a little video, so I can rest my voice for a second here. And this is probably the video that, if I'm famous, this is the one that did it. But it's not me. Hey, I'm not the star of this show. Star of this show are these guys from NIST. You'll see what I mean. Now we'll see if these speakers are turned on.
In August 2008, after a seven-year delay, NIST, the government agency charged with investigating the World Trade Center collapses, released the draft of their final report on the collapse of World Trade Center Building 7 for public comment. In that report, they claimed that the time for the building to fall the first 18 stories, that's the part of the collapse visible on many videos, was 40% longer than it would have taken had it been in free fall. I responded with a video posted on YouTube called WTC7 in Freefall, in which I showed that for approximately 2.5 seconds, Building 7 fell at a rate indistinguishable from freefall. Furthermore, in that video, I showed that NIST's methodology was not a valid way to analyze the true motion of the building. NIST's measurement was not just wrong, it was fraudulent. Then on August 26th, NIST staged a technical briefing in which engineers and others with technical credentials could pose questions. I'm a high school physics teacher, so I figured I would be excluded. However, I went ahead and registered, citing my membership in the American Association of Physics Teachers as my professional affiliation. By the way, I am not speaking for AAPT. That was just my passport into the briefing. To my surprise, my credentials were accepted, and I was able to pose a question. Here's a little of how it went.
Our next question comes from David Chandler of the American Association of Physics Teachers. Any number of competent measurements using a variety of methods indicate the northwest corner of WTC7 fell with an acceleration within a few percent of the acceleration of gravity. Yet your report contradicts this, claiming 40% slower than free fall based on a single data point. How can such a publicly visible, easily measurable quantity be set aside?
Can you repeat the question, please?
Sure. Any number of measurements using a variety of methods indicate the northwest corner of WTC7 fell with an acceleration within a few percent of the acceleration of gravity. Yet the report contradicts this, claiming 40% slower than the free fall based on a single data point?
Well, first of all, gravity is the loading function that applies to the structure, applies to all bodies on this planet, not just in ground zero.
Whoa. I'm used to responses like that on a physics exam when a student hasn't even bothered to open the book. This is NIST speaking, so let's continue.
The analysis showed there's a difference in time between a free fall time. A free fall time would be an object that has no structural components below it. And if you look at the analysis of the video, it shows that the time it takes for the 17, for the roof line of the video to collapse down the 17 floors that you can actually see in the video, below which you can't see anything in the video, is about 3.9 seconds. What the analysis shows, and the structural analysis shows, or the collapse analysis shows, it's that same time that it took for the structural model to come down from the roof line all the way for those 17 floors to disappear is 5.4 seconds. It's about 1.5 seconds, or roughly 40% more time for that free fall to happen. And that is not at all unusual, because there was a structural resistance that was provided in this particular case. And you had a sequence of structural failures that had to take place, and everything was not instantaneous.
Buried in all that verbiage, what Dr. Sundar is saying is, free fall for the 18 stories under consideration would have taken 3.9 seconds. However, their computer model simulating collapse required 5.4 seconds. The slower collapse time was to be expected, since there was structure supporting the building as it fell, slowing the fall. But there was a progression of failures that had to take place, and that these were not instantaneous. All of this makes sense as long as you don't look at the evidence. The evidence shows that free fall actually occurred. But since their computer modeling could not come up with a scenario that would allow for free fall, they had to declare free fall out of bounds and try to cover up the evidence. The problem is, unlike the columns and girders buried deep inside the building, the motion of the building is right out in plain view. Since their model predicted 5.4 seconds for the 18-story collapse, they dutifully conjured up a 5.4-second measurement to match. They had to stretch themselves to do it, but they did it. They found the disappearance time. Then they went out of their way to pick an artificially early start time, exactly 5.4 seconds earlier. This they compared with free fall time.
This next question comes from Dr. Stephen Jones. NIST discusses the fall time for WTC-7 on page 40 of the summary report, where it stated, assuming that the descent speed was approximately constant. However, observations by others of the descent speed show that the building is accelerating rather than being a constant speed. So the question is, why did NIST assume that the descent speed was approximately constant?
Stephen Jones was calling attention to the obviously erroneous claim on page 40 of the draft report that stated that the building descended at constant speed. I'm sure constant speed was a simple misstatement. The correct response should have been, whoops, we'll fix that. But no, here's how they handled that question.
Force of gravity obviously is the acceleration of gravity is what's at the driving force, and our calculation was based on the amount of time from the top of the parapet to fall till it disappeared from view between the two buildings seen in the video. That time was established from the video by a single frame search of the time, so that was down to 1/30th of a second. And then we did the same thing for when the top of the parapet disappeared. We found that that time to be 5.4 seconds.
I didn't hear a whoops in there, did you? This is John Gross, one of the lead engineers for the NIST report on the collapse of the Twin Towers. He has a PhD in structural engineering from Cornell University. He taught engineering at the University of Colorado in Boulder. He has a long resume on top of that. Don't you think he probably knows the difference between speed and acceleration? Don't you think he could explain it with perfect clarity if he wasn't so preoccupied trying to cover his tracks? Don't you find it interesting that the 5.4 seconds he measured for the collapse time just happens to exactly match the theoretical prediction of their model? That kind of precision is incredibly rare when modeling real-world events. Incredible is the right word. It's not credible. This measurement has all the characteristics of what we call dry labbing, manipulating the data to fit a predetermined outcome. It's an ethics violation in science on a par with plagiarism. Any engineers engaging in this kind of sleight of hand should lose their licenses. The larger implication, of course, is dry labbing in this kind of investigation would constitute a criminal cover-up. After another round of quibbling, someone had to step in and bail out poor John.
Can you clarify that?
I think it's something that we need to clarify and collect in the final version of the report.
Okay.
That was August. This is November. The final version of the NIST WTC-7 report just came out. And guess what? We have a revised analysis of the building collapse rate. Constant speed is out. Constant acceleration is out. Instead, we have three phases of collapse, with a whopping 2.25 seconds of absolute freefall. The irrelevant 5.4 seconds is still defended in the wording, but it plays no apparent role other than CYA for John Gross and Associates. So freefall is hereby official dogma. How are they going to handle all the ramifications of that inconvenient fact? Read on. It says, the three stages of collapse progression described above are consistent with the results of the global collapse analysis discussed in Chapter 12 of NIST's NC STAR 1-9. That's it. Freefall went from an impossibility that required backflips and logic to obfuscate to a simple fact to be measured, then declared consistent with their fire-induced collapse hypothesis. Apparently, they have now decided that freefall is okay as long as it is seen as a part of a longer stretch of time that covers the required 5.4 seconds. In other words, they dropped the bullying tactic of blowing smoke to obscure the facts and adopted an alternate bullying tactic, cover it with a lie and walk away. However, NIST cannot walk away from freefall. Now that NIST has certified freefall as fact, take a look at the implications.
Okay. Any questions? Huh? Okay. I was actually going to do a two-part thing, where the second part... Excuse me. Yes. Was it back here?
I know the answer, but how many buildings have actually collapsed due to fire?
You're talking about, okay, if you phrase it, how many steel frame buildings have collapsed due to fire?
Completely due to fire.
Three. All on 9/11, according to their story. And that's it. There are no steel frame buildings. There was one of Bill Warner's friends who was at his little toy event the other day. He said he was an engineer. He was in L.A., and there was, I'm not sure which building he referred to, but it was a large building. It burned for many hours. It was totally engulfed. It was just, excuse me?
First Interstate?
Could well be.
It was First Interstate downtown L.A.
But he was there, and he was actually involved with this somehow. And he said once the whole thing was put out, it was totally destroyed, except they went through it, and they didn't have to touch a thing about the steel structure. They could rebuild right on what was there. Okay, so steel frame buildings, the structure doesn't come down in fires. One of the things is the temperature of burning carbon-based materials like paper and oil or even jet fuel, any of these, the temperature is well below the temperature needed to melt steel. And they quibble all over the place on melting it, weakening it, and stuff like this. But the fact is, experientially, even very severe blazing fires don't cause global collapse like we're seeing here.
You know, even if the steel was exposed, you'd be correct that in the state of New York and probably in most other large cities, don't they require a four-hour fire rating material, which is usually
right. That's right. Well, no, this was covered with a fireproofing material, and there was a lot of asbestos in it, which was one of the issues in this case. But, excuse me? Okay. All right. Well, I really don't want to go too far afield. I mean, And there are people here that can answer a lot of these things, and that would be good if we want to go there. But as far as the question of fireproofing, yes, not only was this steel, but it was fireproofed, at least in the towers, and I'm not sure the status on building 7. Ended up doing, I was going to do a part 2 that was just explaining the implications of their admission of freefall. But while I was working on that, I got curious. I was going to come up with just the explanation or the implications of the freefall. What I got curious about, though, was how did they actually come up with a 5.4-second measurement? So I did a second video which simply identified their starting point. Like, where did they hit the stopwatch to start their 5.4 seconds, okay? Now, since then, I've actually done better than what I did on the video, so I'm going to show you that. Okay. I'm introducing you to a new tool here. This is called AVI DMUX or Avidimux or something. It's basically a little frame manipulating tool here. And what I can do is I have, instead of a movie in here, I have individual frames. I've introduced a clock. If I just run it like a movie, this is exactly the 5.4 seconds. What I did was I went to when when the roof line went to the 29th floor window, which was originally there, and then I went back from there and identified 5.4 seconds earlier. Now, I'm running this slowly backwards, and I want you to tell me when an honest person would start the stopwatch. If this was a race you were timing for the fall of the building, when would you have stopped it? Now, notice, by the way, pretty much when it's on the horizon, it has the corner is stopped. The penthouse is still moving. How about maybe there? No, they went a full second earlier. That's where they started their clock. Now, look at this. If I start, here's that whole first second. There's a little bit of slumping of the penthouse, and that's it. The building itself is not budging. And it's really almost 2 seconds after. So with that in mind, watch the clock and watch when the actual start occurs. So what in the world justifies them starting the clock where they do? John Gross said they looked for a change. There was the first indication of movement of the roof line. They said they looked for a change in a single pixel. All right? Well, first of all, this is a camera that's very far away, and any kind of vibration of the camera, this whole, like the horizon moves around more than a single pixel. Furthermore, the edge, if you get in here with a magnifying glass and start looking at it, the edge is at least 4 or 5 pixels wide. It's like artifacts on the edges. You can't see a sharp edge that cuts off at a single pixel. So it's like a transition of gray in even ending. So even the way he's describing their whole technique, it's phony. There is no justification for choosing this particular instant other than their model, their computer model, predicted 5.4 seconds, and by golly, they were going to come up with 5.4 seconds, and that's exactly what they did. So is that fraudulent? I think it's sort of the definition of fraudulent, where you take a predetermined result and force the data to fit what you want it to come out looking like. So this is very sloppy work for even a high school student trying to cheat on a lab report, but it's somewhere in that same ballpark, okay? Okay. That's a commercial news camera. We're moving now to Building 1, which is the North Tower. And let me just play it first. This is looking at the northwest corner of the North Tower after the collapse has already begun. And just look at the incredible detail of what's going on in here. And then I'm going to focus in on specifics. What do you see? Puffs. Not just one or two. Some of these that look like this one right here have been pointed out, like when they're seen sort of in isolation. Like this would be called a squib, like an explosion that went off sort of out of sequence with the rest of them or something like that. And they say, oh, those squibs, that's just air compressed in the building from all the floors pancaking down like an accordion, and it pushes this air out, and it's going to take all this, it's going to break some windows and take all this dust and stuff with it. Well, what are you really seeing here? You're seeing, if in fact it was the compressed air, you have to have like a closed container to hold the compressed air, don't you? If you compress air and it's free to escape everywhere, you're not going to compress it very much. And notice that there's explosions going on way up here, way down here, and there's even explosions way down underneath the canopy. And it's a little bit hard to see in this video, but I'm going to show you another one in a minute. Right down in here. Watch right down here. Everybody see where I'm pointing? It's a very blatant amount, and it's way the heck ahead of the collapse. Up here is the collapse, right? And way down here, there's these explosions going off. Not just individual isolated ones, it's a continuous wave of demolition running down the building. Now, this is heavy material, free-falling right beside it. And look at the speed with which that wave of explosions comes down. Look at that. It's practically keeping up with this free-falling material. So that would mean, if in fact a naturalistic explanation were accounting for this, that something inside the building is free-falling as fast as this heavy material outside the building and somehow pushing stuff out, it seems much more reasonable to say that there's like a timed sequence of explosions that they just have this like computer control and they just run their finger down all these little switches, so to speak, and they go off in sequence, right? Now, there's a lot of other stuff to be seen. In fact, right here, okay, see this probably a column that's coming out right here that's in the sunlight at the moment, and it falls over like this. Now, I teach over here at Eleanor Roosevelt School. It's a homeschool, charter school type of arrangement, so I'm dealing with a lot of parents. One of the parents was a military demolition person. He was very much, oh, no, this could not have been a demolition. I said, hey, did you ever really see it? Well, not in detail. So I showed it to him. And what he saw was, what he pointed out to me, was this beam right here. Notice all these white streamers coming off of it. Notice the smoke in general is black. And here's all these white streamers coming off of this steel beam. This is not just smoke that got entrained in the wake as this was plowing through the air. This is material coming off of it. Now, as it goes down, notice that this girder here is a little lagging behind this one, right? Now watch what happens as it goes down. Poof, a big ejection of material, and it wins the race. It rushes ahead. So it's like extra material goes and it accelerates as it's coming down here. He immediately said, this is a demolition. I mean, he went a flip-flop from... He was a very conservative person and did not buy into the politics of any of this. And just like that, I mean, he saw this several times, and then he said, this is a demolition, because he actually had a name. I can't even remember the name he had for this. But it's a known type of thing that happens in these explosive demolitions. Now, I am very active in this process, and I actually... came up with an observation that I actually finished documenting at 12:30 last night. So this is a new piece of material coming up here. There's a 9/11 researcher named Graham McQueen, who's from Canada, and he's done some very interesting stuff. But we've been corresponding. And he went down through this and pointed out this little puff right here. Everybody see that little puff? Anything unusual about that little puff? There are some next to it. It's a little different color, but what else? Well, you can't tell that from a freeze frame, but that turns out that's a true statement. But the thing that's interesting, if you notice, is let's say that these are puffs of air. They're blowing out due to compressed air like the official story would indicate, right? It would be pushing out through the windows and things, right? Where is this puff coming from? It's blowing right through the corner of the building. And in fact, he got this zoomed in, and I don't know if I can actually zoom it in just like he did or not, right there. Right, that frame right there. See this? He actually saw it as it's pushing the material off the corner of this building. All right? So this is coming through a steel girder. So he was saying this puff is not a puff of air. This is what they call a cutter charge. In other words, an explosion strapped on to the girder, or in this case the column, to get it to slice the column. And so he pointed that out a week or so ago, and I started looking at that, and I started looking for other similar things. So keep that in mind. We'll come back to that in a minute. All right? Tons of stuff. By the way, one other little factoid here. See these neighboring buildings? There's actually one on the far side that you can't see from here. The bone fragments, millimeter-size bone fragments, were found on the roofs of neighboring buildings. Now think that one through. If you were trapped in this building and it collapsed, what would be your mode of death most likely? You'd be smashed between the collapsing floors, right? Where would you look for your remains? How about in the rubble pile at the bottom, right? In order for bone fragments to get on the roofs of adjacent buildings, your bones, you would have to be pulverized down to that scale and still be out in the open enough to be blown out by what's going on here to be ejected and to have these fragments found nearby like that. Like, how do you have a mechanism that would just involve collapse that could allow these bone fragments to even get there? Okay? And that was a big question. These were found several years after 2001. Some people looked into that. I looked into that myself, and if you look at the flight paths, there's no reasonable way. In other words, the north tower, the plane that hit the north tower came in from the north, and it would not have been in line in any way with this building where the bone fragments were found. The plane that came in from hit the south tower flew over that building before it hit the south tower. So it was moving away from that building. So neither flight had an obvious mechanism where this could have been like fragments of the passengers, for instance. Okay. Okay. All right. I mentioned a moment ago that that one particular row of ejections that was low in the building there. All right, this is from a different angle, and the reason I'm showing this is it's going to show that that same group of ejections. Here's the North Tower starting to collapse. This is the same wall we were looking at a moment ago, and look under here. Can you see that stuff is moving to the right? You see that? So it's not just material coming down. It's a wave of material. Right there, you can just see it blowing left to right, can't you? Did everybody see that? And notice that the wave is progressing. If you follow this, this is large chunks of material here. And it's not exactly the same speed, but it's pretty darn close, right? So it's a wave of explosions that is propagating down the building faster than any mechanism I can imagine other than a time sequence of explosions. Okay? And I have one more, I'll just skip over it, but it's all the same general idea. Okay. Okay, this one is, all right, let me pause this a second. This video is, I don't know why it's doing that. This video is slightly more technical than some of the others that I've actually put on YouTube. However, among those who are like into physics and that type of thing, they point to this one as the most as the most persuasive. So some people are more persuaded by this one. It's a very simple kind of reasoning, but it does imply knowing a little bit of physics. So here goes.
This is the start of the collapse of World Trade Center number 1, also known as the North Tower. We are here tracking the motion of the roofline at 2/10 second intervals through approximately 32 meters, or 8 stories. This graph shows the height of the roofline as a function of time. The analysis is simpler if we plot velocity as a function of time. On this kind of a graph, a straight line indicates constant acceleration. First note that there is a sudden onset of collapse, as the point we are tracking makes a sudden transition from being at rest to an approximately constant downward acceleration. The slope of the graph indicates that the acceleration is 6.31 meters per second squared downward, which is 64% of free fall. In other words, once it starts falling, the upward resistive force is only 36% of the weight of the falling section of the building. So far, so good. But now turn it around. Newton's third law says interactions between objects work both ways. The forces two objects exert on each other are always equal and opposite. If the upward force acting on the falling block is 36% of the weight of the falling block, the downward force exerted by the falling block must be exactly the same, 36% of the weight of the falling block. In other words, the top section of the building is exerting less force on the lower, stronger, undamaged structure than it would if it were simply sitting motionless. Therefore, as long as the top section of the building is in uniform downward acceleration, it cannot possibly be providing sufficient force to destroy the building. This may seem counterintuitive to you. You might think a falling block coming down on the lower section of the building would exert a greater force than a stationary block. But that is true only if the falling block actually impacts the lower block, which would cause the falling block to decelerate. The only way the falling block can continue to accelerate smoothly, as we see here, is for the lower section of the building to give way without significant resistance. If this rate of acceleration continued all the way to the ground, the building would fall in about 11.5 seconds. This is close to the observed collapse time. So far, I've been using the term block loosely. What we actually see here is the falling section of the building turning to dust before our eyes. But what is happening to the upper section of the building behind the dust clouds doesn't really affect this analysis. Given the fact that it is accelerating downward, the top section of the building, whatever its condition, cannot possibly be destroying the lower section of the building. The destruction of the building must be caused by something else.
So, I want to illustrate that. Time for a physics demo. Nail. Wood, hammer, right? Now, if you hit a hammer and you hit a nail, to drive the nail into the wood, then it's going to be resistance there, right? And the hammer is coming down fast, and so there's more force than if I just set the hammer there, right? So if I bring the hammer down, it exerts a greater force. But as the hammer is pushing the nail, what's the nail doing to the hammer? Is pushing up, and that's what brings the hammer to rest, which is why you have to hit it repeatedly, right? It brings it all the way to rest. You got to do it again, and each time you hit it, the way it delivers more than its weight of force to the nail is by this deceleration. And without that deceleration, it doesn't work. Now, how can you arrange a situation where the hammer can just straight out accelerate? Well, if I drive it into styrofoam, I don't know if you can see here, if I just drive it into styrofoam, the hammer can accelerate all the way through because it only takes a small force to push it in, and the nail's not going to push back enough to slow down the hammer, right? So the way that you can get the thing to hit and continue to accelerate is if there's no resistance or very low resistance. So there's some resistance. It was like 36% of the weight. That's what we talked about, right? So that's the kind of the thing that's going on. You cannot have an excess of force. You can't have a, you know, a buildup of force without having a deceleration. So the fact that it's accelerating says this is not exerting the kind of forces that are needed. Therefore, this is like a, almost like QED. This is like the end of the theorem. This can't be crushing that. It is falling into a pre-pulverized mass of material. Okay. Now there's some details in here, which we've also thought through, but I mean that's the general idea right there. Okay. Now I want to come back to, this is the same video I just used. Okay, this is in AVI DMUX again, so I can just run the frames any way I want, okay? What I'd like you to first of all notice is what's happening to this upper block. So pay attention to this line here where all the flames are occurring and the roof line, and notice the separation of those two.
And what's the location of where the plane hit?
The plane hit right here. Flames are below, and so forth, right? Now, look at this. Here's the roof line. Here's that same line where the flames were. And this has not started moving down the building yet. Okay? So what the very first thing that's being destroyed in this process is this upper block. So to call it an upper block is sort of fictitious. What happened originally, if you watch the NOVA program soon after 9/11, they said what it was pancaking floors. Now, the problem with pancaking floors as the way that these things collapsed is the core structure of these towers is not, it's 47 very major vertical columns that are huge, and they taper as they go up, but they're absolutely huge down at the bottom. And they're also very, very solidly interconnected. And this would just stand entirely on its own. And so if the floors pancake down, what you'd have is this big steel tower left behind. So in other words, the floor pancaking theory did not account for the destruction of the towers in this complete way that we actually saw. And so what NIST did was NIST rejected the floor pancaking explanation and said instead that the top section of the building acted like a pile driver to crush the columns below it. But what we just demonstrated is you can't crush the columns and have this effect that we observed of constant acceleration of this as it moves through it. So that's one. And secondly, that top section of the building destroys itself, and so it can't even act like a pile driver. And that one where we saw the northwest corner, you can't even see a top section at all. The destruction is going on right at the top of where we see it. We'll be seeing that again in a second. Okay. Now, I want to show you one other thing about, there's a lot of things, again, here to look for. But I want to run it down till we see the start of collapse. Boom. Now, I think what's on the screen up there is a little darker than what I'm seeing on my computer screen. But I started looking because Graham McQueen had talked about puffs coming out of the corners, right? Look at that. There's a puff. I don't know if you can see it on the screen, right there. You see it? I'm going to move this back and forth a little. You see how it puffs out to the right? Right there. See that? Now, somebody go, Merrily, go up there and the base of that puff, put your finger right there on the screen. Yeah, just a little up, down, right there. You see what we're talking about? Now, notice that the floors here are coming down. Oh, go, go back, right there. Right there, all right. The floors are coming down. What's happening to that puff? Is it following her finger or is it following the descending floors? It doesn't move. It's staying right where Merrily's finger is. So this little puff is fixed relative to something that's standing still, that's not coming down. Thank you. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to put my cursor there, and I'm going to use the arrow keys, and let's watch what we see after the stuff has come down. Do you see anything? You see this thing just over to the right a little bit, like right there? Now, you see how that top of that, it's a column. This is that corner column. Notice how the top of this corner column is at exactly the same height as that little puff. Like, why would the corner column be right to that little puff? Well, it sure looks to me like that little puff was another cutter charge that severed the column. Now notice how as the building continues to fall, that column stays supported there. You see that?
Yeah.
All right. Now, boom, there it goes. It went into free fall, didn't it? Now, last night at up till 12:30 last night, I took that tracker program and I put those little dots. I started off putting a series of dots on this little puff, right? And I went bing, 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 right here every time at the root of the puff, and it basically verified it stayed right at the same level. It didn't move down the building at all. It just stayed there, okay? Then I had a gap while it went through all this stuff, and then as soon as I could see the column, I started putting the mark on the top of the column. And you can actually see that the top of the column starts off right at that same level. It sort of rocks down, so it comes down a little bit, and then it descends into free fall. Boom. Now, my suspicion was, is this the same column that Graham McQueen was looking at the other end? Okay? So let's go back and look at that. Okay? So you guys are seeing fresh research here that has not been turned into a video or anything else yet. Now, okay, here's the northwest corner, sort of a famous video. Do you see anything that could be that column? Look at that thing up there. That's the same column. And I went back and forth. And so one of the things I had to do was to somehow correlate these two. If I want to show that the other end of this column is this cutter charge thing down here, I figured if I could show that the moment that this started to free fall is the same as the moment that this little puff went off, that would indicate this thing is being supported. Puff, this thing goes off, cuts the girder here, the column here, and then it free fall. Okay? So that was the goal. To do that, I had to somehow synchronize the frames of these two videos. So look at this little column up here. Look at the column up the top. Look at that, it's in sunlight, it's in the shadow. And then as it's in the sunlight, it disappears from the sunlight. Bing, right there. You could get the last little glimmer of sunlight landing on this, right? Well, the other video, I'm not going to go back to it right now, the other video, you can see the same thing. You can see the column enter the sunlight, and then when it sort of glistens when it's in the sunlight, and then as the very last corner of that column disappears from the sunlight, you can then identify the frame number from that video and correlate it with this frame number. Down here it says frame 78 down there. So frame 78 of this video and frame whatever the number was on the other one. Okay. So then I went back and did the analysis on the other one and I used tracker and I figured out, okay, here's when, boom, it starts accelerating downward. I found when that occurred. I converted it over to this one. I believe it occurred on this one at around 17, 18, 19, right around in there, okay? So let's go back to frame, here's 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, what's going on? So basically, that nails it. that what we're looking at is this event here coincides exactly with when the measurement of the top of this thing enters free fall. So we're actually seeing this puff cut this column. The significance of this, I want to point this out. There's all of this argumentation that how what we're seeing is stuff being puffed out by air. If it's puffed out by air, it's going to go out through windows. It's going to break through one floor at a time, which we can see is not the case. And yet what we see here is an example where the little cloud is coming out through a girder, and the effect of it coming out through the girder is at this one, the top one, it cuts off the top of the column at that level. The bottom one, it actually sets this whole column into free fall. So we have both ends of this column, we have nailed it, that we are seeing explosive charges cut columns. Let that sink in. So this is very graphic evidence that we're actually seeing what everybody would guess that we're seeing from first glance, but this is the kind of nailing it down to where it makes it very hard to deny. All right. I have a couple others here. Let me just see what I have left here. I did another investigation. This is a little bit different kind of thing. One of the questions I have, a lot of people in the truth movement sort of loosely use the concept of free fall and say the Twin Towers came down at free fall or close to free fall or various things like that, right? As you saw a few minutes ago, the roof line of the North Tower came down up and it came down until it disappeared into the rubble about this level. It came down at about roughly two-thirds of free fall. It was at 0.64, I believe, right? So what I've done is I've put two markers on here. There's a blue one and there's a red one that's superimposed on there right now. And the blue one is going to come down at free fall. The red one's going to come down at the 64% of free fall. And to see whether that same rate holds all the way down the building. So notice that it's clearly not falling at free fall. Okay, and look at that. The building's still way up here. So obviously it did not come all the way down at 64% of free fall either. If the red one, when the red one hits the ground, it would be about 11 seconds. Jim Hoffman's measurements for the collapse of the building, he's been very critical of this kind of loose claim made by people in the truth movement. And he said that actually the evidence points to about 16 seconds for the tower to fall all the way. So it is slower than either of these. However, I noticed something else along the way. Something is keeping up with that red bar. What do you see happening right here? These are those explosions inside the building pushing stuff out. That's coming out way down here. On the top of the building is up here. And by the way, where's that pile driver, huh? Show me a pile driver. It's not there. But something's going on that is, in fact, keeping up all the way down to here. It's keeping up with this red bar. All right? So, what am I doing? I'm making little observations based on what I can do. I hunt around. I'm looking based on, hey, I have a perspective that I can apply to this kind of inquiry. And it's not like I'm just focused on one little thing. It's just I'm looking for whatever I can find that's going to work. All right? And I have a bunch of others. I'm not going to even go there because I think we've gone on long enough here. But I'm going to just put it out here. I have my own personal 9/11 website, which is easy enough to remember, or you can write it down when you get a chance, but it's 911speakout.org. So 911speakout.org. I have all of my videos I put on YouTube, I have embedded copies of them there. Our organization's website is ae911truth.org. So AE stands for Architects and Engineers for 9/11 Truth. The purpose of the organization is to testify to the general public that people with some expertise in knowing what they're looking at in large numbers are calling for a new investigation. So there's people in the organization with varying degrees of skepticism about the official story, actually. Most of those in the inner circle are absolutely convinced that that this is a demolition. However, the basis for being on the petition is you're calling for a new investigation.